This channel has been established for visually impaired people. For the visually impaired people, voice narration and a written expression are also provided for the hearing impaired. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel. The Ladbroke Grove rail crash, also known as the Paddington train crash, was a rail accident which occurred on 5 October 1999 at Ladbroke Grove in London, United Kingdom, with 31 people killed and more than 520 injured. This remains the worst rail accident on the Great Western Main Line. This was the second major accident on the Great Western Main Line in just over 2 years, the first being the Southall rail crash of September 1997. A few miles west of this accident, both crashes would have been prevented by an operational automatic train protection ATP system, wider fitting of which had been rejected on cost grounds. This severely damaged public confidence in the management and regulation of safety of Britain's privatised railway system. A public inquiry into the crash by Lord Cullen was held in 2000. Since both the Paddington and Southall crashes had reopened public debate on ATP, a separate joint inquiry considering the issue in the light of both crashes was also held in 2000. It confirmed the rejection of ATP and the mandatory adoption of a cheaper and less effective system, but noted a mismatch between public opinion and cost-benefit analysis. The Cullen inquiry was carried out in two blocks of sittings, sandwiching the joint inquiry. The first block dealt with the accident itself, the second block dealt with the management and regulation of UK railway safety. This had always been part of the inquiry terms of reference, but was given additional urgency by a further train crash at Hatfield in October 2000. Major changes in the formal responsibilities for management and regulation of safety of UK rail transport ensued. Contents: 1. Incident. 2. Immediate cause. 3. Contributory factors. 31. Problems with signal visibility. 32. Problems with signal visibility management. 33. Disjointed and ineffective SPAD reduction initiatives. 34. Problems with driver training. 4. Other issues. 41. Train protection. 42. Flank protection. 43. Response of signalmen. 44. Regulatory shortcomings. 5. Wider ramifications. 51. National policy on train protection systems. 52. Management and regulation of rail safety. 6. Aftermath. 7. Dramatization. 8. See also. 9. Further reading. 10. References. 11. External links. Incident at about 8:06 British Summer Time on 5 October 1999. A Thames train service to Bedwen Railway Station in Wiltshire left Paddington Station from Paddington to Ladbroke Grove Junction about 2 miles 32. And at a combined speed of about 130 miles per hour 210. Which it should have been held. It was established that the signal had been showing a red aspect, and the preceding signal SN87 had been showing a single yellow, which should have led the driver to be prepared for a red at SN109. Since the Thames turbo driver, 31-year-old Michael Hodder, had been killed in the accident, it was not possible to establish why he had passed the signal at danger. However, Hodder was inexperienced, having qualified as a driver only 2 weeks before the crash. His driver training was found to be defective, whilst the signalling in the Paddington area was known to have caused problems. SN109 had been passed at danger on 8 occasions in 6 years, but Hodder had no specific warning of this. Furthermore, 5 October 1999 was a day of bright sunshine, and at just past 8 o'clock the sun would have been low and behind Hodder, with low sunlight reflecting off yellow aspects. Poor signal placement meant that Hodder would have seen sunlit yellow aspects of SN109 at a point where his view of the red aspect of SN109 but not of any other signal on the gantry was still obstructed. The inquiry considered it more probable than not that the poor sighting of SN109, both in itself and in comparison with the other signals on and at gantry 8, allied to the effect of bright sunlight at a low angle, were factors which had led Hodder to believe that he had a precede aspect. Since 1998, a campaign to have the signal SN109 properly sighted had been running, and the Bristol HST drivers were rerouted as not to pass this signal. Citation needed. Contributory factors. The inquiry noted that the lines into Paddington were known to be prone to signal passed at danger SPAD events. In particular, there had been 8 SPADs at signal SN109 in the preceding 6 years, and attempted to identify the underlying causes. Problems with signal visibility. Paddington approaches had been resignalled by British Rail in the early 1990s to allow bidirectional working. The number of signals and limited trackside space meant that most signals were in gantries over the tracks. The curvature of the the lines meant that it was not always obvious which signal was for which track. Reflective line identification signs had therefore been added, but, the inquiry report noted, they were closer to the signal to the right-hand side than to the signal for the line to which they related. However, misreading of which signal related to which track cannot have caused the fatal crash, because at the time all the other gantry 8 signals were also showing red. The spacing between signals and points was designed to allow fast through running by freight trains and meant that gantry 8 was less than 100. Yellow. The Paddington resignalling scheme had been implemented ahead of formal HMRI approval. This had still not been received at the time of the crash. The line had subsequently been electrified to allow the new Heathrow Express service to operate from 1994, and the new overhead electrification equipment further obstructed drivers' view of signals. From the outset, there was not an adequate overall consideration of the difficulties which would face drivers, in particular in signal sighting, on which the safety of travellers critically depended. Secondly, when difficulties did emerge, there was not an adequate reconsideration of the scheme. There was a resistance to questioning what had already been done. Cost, delay and interference with the performance objectives underlay that resistance. The red aspect of SN109 was particularly badly obscured by the overhead electrification equipment. It was last of all the gantry 8 signal aspects to become clearly visible to the driver of a class 165 approaching from Paddington. Problems with signal visibility management. All new or altered signals or which had had multiple SPADs should have been reviewed for sighting issues by a signal sighting committee, but none had been held for signals around Paddington since Railtrack assumed responsibility for this in April 1994. An internal audit in March 1999 had reported this, but a follow-up audit in September 1999 found no evidence of any remedial action being taken. The failure to have signal sighting committees convened was persistent and serious. It was due to a combination of incompetent management and inadequate process, the latter consisting in the absence of a process at a higher level for identifying whether those who were responsible for convening such committees were or were not doing so. There had been over the years a number of proposals or recommendations for the risk assessment of the signaling in the Paddington area. None of them was carried into effect. Multiple SPADs at SN109 in August 1998 should have triggered a risk assessment. None took place. An inquiry into a February 1998 SPAD at SN109 had already recommended risk assessment of signaling on the Paddington, Ladbroke Grove bi-directional lines. This and many other inquiry recommendations had not been implemented. The Railtrack employee with formal responsibility for action tracking had been told his responsibility ended once someone accepted an action, and did not extend to checking that they had acted upon it. Disjointed and ineffective SPAD reduction initiatives. Between February 1998 and the accident, there had been 4 separate groups set up with the aim of reducing SPADs. Their existence, membership and functions overlapped. A Railtrack manager told the inquiry how he struggled on his arrival in October 1998 to understand how so many apparently good people could produce so little action. People had burdens that were too complex. They were not prioritizing, people were square pegs in round holes, some were not competent, and, in summary, the culture of the place had gone seriously adrift over many years. The chief executive of Railtrack spoke of a seemingly endemic culture of complacency and inaction, which he said reflected the culture of the old British Rail. The culture is one in which decisions are delegated upwards. There has been little empowerment. People have tended to manage reactively, not proactively. The basic management discipline of plan do review is absent. The further down the organization one goes, problems with driver training. Thames Trains had inherited a driver training package from British Rail, but this had evolved to the point where in February 1999, a concerned incoming training manager commissioned an external audit which reported the trainers did not appear to be following the training course syllabus and supporting notes, as they considered these to be not fit for purpose with inappropriate time allowances for some sessions. The traction and introduction to driving section of the course has been extended, and the 6-week route learning session is being used as additional practical handling. Indeed, Michael Hodder's 16 weeks practical training had been given by a trainer who felt that I was not there to teach the routes, I was totally to teach how to drive a turbo. The training manager was unaware of this. Details of signals which had been repeatedly passed at danger should have been supplied to trainers and passed into trainees. No trainer had done so, and the practical trainer quoted above was unaware that SN109 was a multi-SPAD. Signal testing of trainees was similarly unstructured and unstandardized, with no clear pass-fail criteria. Under the previous British Railways training regime, trainees would have spent far longer in training and, once qualified, were not allowed to drive over the notoriously difficult difficult approach to Paddington until they had at least 2 years' experience on less complex routes. Hodder had only qualified 13 days earlier. He was ex-Navy with no previous experience as a railway worker, but no special attention was paid to this in either training or testing. It must be concluded therefore that training was not adequate for the task for which he was being prepared. The very favorable comments made as to his progress by his various teachers have to be viewed against the background that his teachers were working with a less than perfect training program. Other issues: train protection. The Thames train had been fitted with AWS automatic warning system, which required the driver to acknowledge a warning every time he approached a signal not at green. If an automatic train protection ATP system had been fitted and working, it would have automatically applied brakes to prevent the train going beyond any signal at red. National adoption of ATP, British Rail's preferred train protection system, had been recommended after the Clapham Junction rail crash, but later abandoned because the safety benefits were considered not great enough to justify the cost. After a previous SPAD, Thames Trains had commissioned a cost-benefit analysis CBA study specific to the Paddington situation, which came to the same conclusion. The Ladbroke Grove accident was felt to cast doubt on the wisdom of these decisions. However, the Cullen inquiry confirmed that CBA would not support the adoption of ATP by Thames Trains flank protection. The design of the points on the approaches to Paddington did not provide flank protection, where the points beyond a signal at red are set so that a train passing the signal at red is routed so as to minimize the possible consequences. This would have meant routing a train running past SN109 at red onto the down relief line. This should have been considered at the design stage, when it would have been easy to implement. The reasons for not doing so were not known, but it was noted that the introduction of automatic train protection ATP had been thought to be imminent. Flank protection would have increased the overlap, the distance for which a train could run past the signal before fouling other lines at SN109. The desirability of doing so should have been considered by the risk assessment, which had not taken place. Response of signalmen. The written instructions for Railtrack Signalling Centre staff at SLU were that as soon as they realised that a train had passed a signal at danger, they should set signals to danger and immediately send a radio emergency all stop signal to the driver of the train by cab secure radio CSR as soon as they realised that it had done so. In the event, only when the Thames train was 200 metres past the signal did they start to send a radio emergency all-stop signal. It is not clear whether the signal was actually sent before the crash. Their understanding of the instructions was that they should wait to see if the driver stopped of his own accord before attempting to contact him. This interpretation was supported by their immediate manager. The signalmen had never been trained in the use of CSR, nor had they ever used it in response to a SPAD. The general picture which emerged was of a slack and complacent regime, which was not alive to the potentially dire consequences of a SPAD or of the way in which signalers could take action to deal with such situations. Regulatory shortcomings. The Health and Safety Executive's HM Railway Inspectorate was also criticised for its inspection procedures. The then head of HSE told the inquiry the HSE were concerned about, first, the length of time taken for the approval of the signalling scheme, secondly, the slow progress by Railtrack and the HMRI in bringing issues to a conclusion, and, thirdly, the inadequate risk analysis. Matters had not been followed up with more urgency. More could have been done to enforce health and safety legislation. She attributed these deficiencies to three causes: a lack of resources on the part of the HMRI, a lack of vigour by the HMRI in pursuing issues, and the placing of too much trust in the duty holders. Wider ramifications. National policy on train protection systems. A fortnight before the accident, the HSE had announced an intention to require the adoption of TPWS, an upgrade of AWS, which could stop trains travelling at less than 70 year. Between Ladbroke Grove and the joint inquiry, the rail industry, if not the general public, had become largely committed to the adoption of TPWS. Consequently, although the joint inquiry expressed considerable reservations about the effectiveness of TPWS, it concurred with its adoption. The joint inquiry noted that public reaction to catastrophic rail accidents should be and is taken into account in the making of decisions about rail safety, but did not align with the output of CBA. Any future ATP system will entail expenditure at levels many times higher than that indicated by any approach based upon CBA. Despite its cost, there appears to be a general consensus in favor of ATP. Both TPWS and ETCS would be mandatory, and therefore their cost implications need not be considered by any body other than the UK government and the EU Commission. Management and regulation of rail safety. The inquiry noted evidence that railway safety statistics had not worsened after privatisation, nor had there been any evidence that, however privatisation operation had been carried out, it would have been detrimental to safety. Concerns were, however, expressed about how privatization had been carried out. The fragmentation of the industry had created numerous, complex interfaces exacerbated by defensive or insular attitudes expected to worsen in the future as managers who had got broader experience in BR passed out of the system. It also gave problems with the management, development and implementation of large-scale projects, and meant that little real research and development was being carried out. The quality of safety leadership and communications varied between the various successor organizations. A stress on performance targets had diluted the perceived importance of safety. Cullen contrasted multi-million pound penalties for poor punctuality with much lower fines for serious safety breaches. Train operating company TOC franchise had been awarded for too short a period, and with inadequate consideration of safety aspects. Railtrack relied extensively on contractors to carry out safety-critical work. There were too many contracting organizations. Contracts were for too short a period, and were inadequately supervised by Railtrack beyond the obvious exhortations to do better. The inquiry endorsed in its recommendations a number of changes in the industry structure. Railtrack had not merely had responsibility for railways infrastructure, but also a lead responsibility for safety, both for acceptance of TOC safety cases and for setting railway group standards, system-wide standards on matters affecting safety, since it also had commercial interests in these issues. The rest of the industry was unhappy with this. Cullen recommended that safety case acceptance should be directly by HSE in future, and a new body should be set up to manage railway group standards. In 1996, ScotRail had initiated the creation of a rail safety group, later to become CERAS, by a team from Strathclyde University. Other rail lines expressed interest in the project, and several rail lines in Scotland voluntarily joined the system following the Ladbroke Grove rail crash. John Prescott mandated that all mainline rail in the UK come under the confidential incident reporting. Railway Inspectorate standards setting, accident investigation and regulation functions were henceforth clearly separated, on the model of the aviation industry. On 5 April 2004, Thames Trains was fined a record £2 million after admitting violations of health and safety law in connection with the accident. It was also ordered to pay £75,000 in costs. On 31 October 2006, Network Rail, the successor body to Railtrack, formed in the wake of a subsequent train crash at Hatfield, pleaded guilty to charges under the Health and Safety at Work Act 1974 in relation to the accident. It was fined £4 million on 30 March 2007, and was also ordered to pay £225,000 in costs. Signal SN109 was brought back into service in February 2006. It and many other signals in the Paddington area are now single-lens type signals. A memorial garden has been set up, partially overlooking the crash site and accessible from the adjacent Sainsbury's supermarket. Market car park. Power car 43011 sustained heavy damage in the crash and was subsequently written off, being officially withdrawn in November after the completion of the inquiry of the incident. It was cut up by Sims Metals in Crewe, Cheshire in June 2002. Apart from one of the prototypes, it is one of the only three Class 43 HST locomotives power cars to be scrapped. The turbo train was also written off in the accident. While the front two carriages were scrapped, the rear carriage was undamaged and is now a spare carriage. Pam Warren wrote the book From Behind the Mask, which narrates her experiences during the crash, her recovery, and how it has affected her life and relationships. Dramatization on 20 September 2005, Derailed, a 90-minute documentary drama program based on the Ladbroke Grove crash, was aired on BBC One. This dramatization was heavily criticized in the railway press, with the editor of Rail magazine, Nigel Harris, describing it as a trashy piece of subjective storytelling. Issue 523. The program stated that the chronology of actual events had been changed, and some scenes fabricated, to add clarity. On 19 September 2011, National Geographic Channel aired an episode of Seconds from Disaster exploring the chain of events that had led up to the collision. See also Southall rail crash, an earlier incident on the Great Western Main Line caused by a SPAD signal passed at danger, also involving a high-speed train. 2005 Glendale train crash, an incident in the United States which was also followed by a fire caused by spilt diesel. Further reading Hall, Stanley. 2003 Beyond Hidden Dangers, Railway Safety into the 21st Century. Ian Allen. ISBN Carat Inquiry Report Volume 1 Para 577 Carat Inquiry Report Volume 1 Para 5111 Carat Phase 1 Commission July 1993 Inquiry Report Volume 1 Para 74 Carat Inquiry Report Volume 1 Para 74 Carat Inquiry Report Volume 1 Para 519 Carat Inquiry Report Volume 1 Para 517 Carat Inquiry Report Volume 1 Para 319 Carat Inquiry Report Volume 1 Para 510 Carat Inquiry Report Volume 1 Para 512 Carat Inquiry Report Volume 1 Para 515 Carat Partly because HMRI did not want to take a view until prosecutions arising out of the Southall crash had been resolved. Inquiry Report Volume 1 Para 109 Carat Inquiry Report Volume 1 Para 716 Carat Inquiry Report Volume 1 Para 574 Carat Inquiry Report Volume 1 Para 731 Carat Inquiry Report Volume 1 Para 738 Carat Inquiry Report Volume 1 Para 742 Carat The report speaks of a culture of apathy and lack of will to follow up promised actions Inquiry Report Volume 1 Para 741 Carat Inquiry Report Volume 1 Para 745 Carat Inquiry Report Volume 1 Para 747 Carat Inquiry Report Volume 1 Para 796 Carat Inquiry Report Volume 1 Para 7103 Carat AB Inquiry Report Volume 1 Para 7107 Carat Inquiry Report Volume 1 Para 7115 Whilst conversely the HSE blamed a move away from British Rail behaviours for their failure to regulate effectively. Carat Inquiry Report Volume 1, Para 543 Carat Inquiry Report Volume 1, Para 545 Carat Vaughan 2003 Carat Locomotion No. 1 Dissimulation OPCIT Carat Inquiry Report Volume 1, Para 546 Carat Inquiry Report Volume 1, Paris 83-5 Carat Inquiry Report Volume 1, Paris 810-24 Carat Inquiry Report Volume 1, Paris 850-54, which however suggest that CBA should not be the sole input into the decision Carat Inquiry Report Volume 1 Para 718 Carat Inquiry Report Volume 1 Para 720 Carat Inquiry Report Volume 1 Para 628-30 Carat The inconsistencies of the evidence of the signalers raise questions as to the reliability and even the credibility of some of that evidence Inquiry Report Volume 1 Para 625 Carat Inquiry Report Volume 1 Para 640 Carat Inquiry Report Volume 1, Para 631-37 Carat Inquiry Report Volume 1, Para 641 Carat Inquiry Report Volume 1, Paris 1017-18 Carat specifically that it had been assumed that, as with BR, there would be openness with the regulator and delivery on promises Inquiry Report Volume 1, Paris 1021 Carat Although, as the joint inquiry noted, 2004 had been regarded as the best achievable, this acceleration was done in the light of strong public criticism of railway management Carat whilst explicitly denying that its hands were tied Carat here meaning any train protection system, the joint inquiry referred to the ex-BRATP as BRATP Carat Inquiry Report Part 2 Paris 45-6 Carat Inquiry Report Part 2 Para 420 Carat Inquiry Report Part 2 Para 418 Carat Inquiry Report Part 2 Para 460 Carat For example, ATOC cited as an example of potential conflict the requirement that had been made in April 2000 that train operators should fit sanders to all their trains They pointed out that problems with low adhesion were commercial disadvantageous to Railtrack Inquiry Report Part 2 Para 827 Carat Inquiry Report Part 2 Chapter 8 Carat Improving Safety-Related Rules Compliance in the Public Transportation Industry, PPA 105, at Google Books ISBN 0309213355X Carat CIRAS, the Rail Industry's Confidential Reporting System, retrieved 14 March 2013. Post retrieved 31 July 2014. Harrow 1838 Lewisham 1857 Kentish Town 1861 Norwood Junction 1891 Ilford 1915 Battersea Park 1937, Ilford 1944 King's Cross 1945 South Croydon 1947 Harrow and Wealdstone 1952 Stratford 1953 Barnes 1955 Lewisham 1957 Dagenham East 1958 Hither Green 1967, Eltham Well Hall 1972 Ealing Wrestling 1973 Moorgate 1975. Holborn 1980 Wembley Central 1984 Clapham Junction 1988 Purley 1989 Cannon Street 1991, Southall 1997 Ladbroke Grove 1999, Spa Road 1999 Croydon 2016 Rail accidents in the United Kingdom VE Railway accidents in 1999. Xanthus, Western Australia 18 August Ladbroke Grove, United Kingdom 5 October Glenbrook, Australia 2 December 1998 2000 Coordinates, 51 degrees 31 minutes 26 seconds North 0 degrees 12 minutes 43 seconds West, 51524 degrees North 0212 degree W, 51524, 0212.